Atma Namaste. Let us start with divine blessings. To the Supreme God, Divine Father, Mother, Guru, Master, Jokuk Sui, you can pray to your own spiritual teacher, Maha Guruji Meling, all the great, great ones, holy gurus, holy masters, saints, archangels, holy angels, spiritual helpers, all divine helpers, invisible helpers, Buddha Kwanin, Buddha Shakyamuni, all Bodhisattvas, the beings of light, our divine self and higher soul. We humbly invoke for your divine blessings, divine light, divine love and divine power, for divine peace, illumination, divine grace, divine guidance, divine mercy, divine forgiveness, for divine help, divine healing, divine support, divine protection, abundance, prosperity, growth, success, progress. All these blessings, may they come to us on all levels through time and space. Thank you, God, for enabling us, entitling us to attend all these sessions that are, you know, being conducted every day, showering your priceless teachings, understanding of every little concept of the universe, which would help us in enhancing our lives, mastering our virtues, and uplifting our lifestyle, embracing the holy and the wholesome energies, divine energies of the universe, making our lives healthy, hearty, and wholesome, being channels of peace, channels of prosperity, abundance, channels of healing, healing people's lives, motivating others, being channels of peace, showering and radiating peace, love, joy, mercy, happiness, prosperity, abundance, success, growth, progress. Thank you, God, for all your divine, miraculous blessings. That we are alive today, that we are breathing, we are healthy, we are comfortable, we are safe, we are secured, we are protected. We are seeing, we are touching, feeling, sensing, hearing everything that we are having in our life. It is so amazing that you are taking special care of our lives, of our homes, our family members, our loved ones. We are deeply, deeply grateful for all these miraculous blessings, miraculous healings and miraculous manifestations and materializations in our life. Thank you, God. Thank you in full faith. So be it. So be it. So it is. I connect to you, God, within. I am that I am. Visualize a bright star, a glowing golden lotus above your head. That is the light of your own soul. I am the soul. I am a spiritual being of divine love, divine peace. I am a being of spiritual light and pure energy. I am a being of divine love, light, and power. I am in full control, permanent and complete control over my body, my emotions and my mind. So be it. I am that I am. I am super receptive, super conductive, and super, super grateful, God. Super receptive, super conductive towards you, Parabrahman, and towards my Sadguru, who is the eternal parent of all my lifetimes, who is taking care of my soul's growth, of everything that I do, guiding me divinely, protecting me divinely, and blessing me with the awards and achievements that I'm scoring as a soul in the land of heaven, in the land of God. Thank you, God, for everything, everything. Thank you. I am that I am. Now tap your heart with your heart chakra with your left hand and your crown, your head with your right hand. Tap it. Activate your heart and your crown. Visualize, when you're tapping your heart, visualize that Master Chokok Sui, our Guru, is in our heart. Visualize he's there. When you're tapping your crown, visualize Maha Guruji sitting over here. Visualize Lord Padmasambhava sitting on the lotus, that golden lotus, which is the soul light. And visualize your higher soul, which is above, far above. You know that is your real soul, which has a bright light. Visualize Mother Kuan Yin over there. That is our spiritual lineage. Mother Kuan Yin, she gives abundance through her hands, drops abundance like a waterfall. Visualize she's there on your higher soul, pouring down healing, peace, mercy, compassion, and forgiveness. That's the beauty of our spiritual school. That's the beauty of connecting. Now take your hands up in a blessing position. Visualize Mother Earth in front of you. Lord God, Lord Parabrahman, make me a channel of your peace. Let me be a pipe which will bring down peace from heaven to earth. So bless Mother Earth with peace. Bless your family members, your loved ones, your home, your projects, your dreams, desires, wishes, all your neighbors, friends, your city, your country, and Mother Earth. May everyone be blessed with peace, with love, with joy. Make me an instrument of your love, of your light. Where there is darkness, let me bring light. Where there is sadness, let me bring joy. Where there is despair, let me bring despair, depression, let me bring hope. Where there is doubt, let me bring faith. Where there is darkness, let me bring light. Where there is poverty, let me bring prosperity. Where there is lack, let me bring abundance. Where there is suffering, let me bring healing. Where there is pain and suffering, let me bring healing. Where there is cruelty, let me bring compassion. Let me bring mercy and forgiveness. Lord God, make me a channel of all these beautiful energies, that through me these flow into all the people, all the beings on Mother Earth, and all souls and sentient beings in all eight directions, in all dimensions. May everyone experience healing, peace, tranquility, bliss, contentment, joy, happiness. May everyone be healed on all levels. May everyone be forgiven. I forgive all the souls, all the sentient beings who have hurt me on any level, anywhere. May everyone be healed with God's healing energies. I forgive all of you for all the mistakes you have done to me on all levels, physically, emotionally, mentally, financially, spiritually, or socially, relationship-wise. I forgive you all. On all levels, through time, if you have hurt me in the past, present, or you are supposed to hurt me in the future, I forgive you. I forgive you on all levels, through time and through space. No matter where we have met or where we will be, I forgive you completely and permanently. I I humbly seek your forgiveness, all of your forgiveness, to whoever I have hurt, injured, harmed, in any level, anywhere, anytime, in all levels, through time and space. Please forgive me. May love, peace, harmony, and oneness be between you and me. May you and I be completely and permanently healed. I release you from all of you, from all negative karmic cords, bonds, connections, and all negative karmas. I release you on all levels, through time and space. Om Shanti, 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 Om. Be in peace, go in peace. Be in peace, go in peace. Be in peace, go in peace. Cut all negative karmic connections and cords and bonds. Cut, cut, cut. All these energy cords we need to detach so that it does not, all their anger, hatred does not come on to us again. Now visualize your aura, your energy body. You have an invisible energy body around your physical body. Visualize smoky, dark, gray clouds, cloudy smoke going out from every organ, every cell of your body, from every part of your body. These are all the energies of anger, hatred, jealousy that they had dumped on you. Let us release all those completely and permanently from all levels. Tell yourself, I, the soul, I release all these negative energies, negative emotions, negative thoughts, negative feelings of others and of self from all levels of my system. So be it. Now cut cords with all these negative energies so that these does not come back. Cut, cut, cut. Lord God, since I have forgiven, I'm entitled to be forgiven. I thank you for forgiving me completely and permanently on all levels through time and space. Thank you for forgiving me for all the mistakes I have done in all lifetimes, on any level, to anyone, anywhere. Thank you for neutralizing all my past karmas and blessing me with a completely and permanently healed life on all levels, a wholesome life on all levels through time and space. Thank you for blessing me with divine love, divine healing, divine health, divine protection, mercy, forgiveness, and with prosperity and abundance. And a wholesome, wholesome life on all levels through time and space. Thank you, God. Thank you for everything. Thank you in full faith. So be it. So be it. So it is. Om. Amen. Amin. Tathastu. Tathastu. So it is. Atma Namaste to all of you. You know, I had not decided what I will, as I do, I don't decide. But when I do the invocation, that time somehow I'm guided by Master and Mahaguruji what I should take, what session I should take. So I got one kind of guidance, which will be different from the sessions that we are doing. It is about life experiences, which, you know, we learn from each other's life experiences, right? That is how we grow. So I was just guided to share some of my life experiences, maybe because I was just sharing it the other day. Saturday evening, I had some guests, our neighbors who had come down. And, you know, we were talking about our childhood. So all of us were talking about our childhood. And when I was sharing, you know, they said, my God, such a rich experience you have. So maybe that's why I was guided, because they said we've learned so many things from these. So one is that, what we teach, we should actually preach. Preach means we should practice, practice what you teach, then only it becomes preach. I remember Gandhiji, I had read somewhere that Gandhiji, somebody came to Gandhiji and said, Gandhiji, I am having a lot of gur, you know, that jaggery. I'm having a lot of, I'm addicted to it. What should I do? Tell me, how should I get over it? So Gandhiji said, yeah, I will tell you, you come back after a week. So that child came back after a week and said, yes, I've come back, you had told me. Then Gandhiji gave him a solution how to go about it. Then this boy said, it is such a simple solution. Why didn't you tell me a week before when I came to you? Gandhiji said, I could not, because I was also addicted to it. I had not, you know, left it. So how can I teach you when I am not practicing it myself? Only when I practice it myself can I teach. Or maybe I am in the process. I'm not perfect. You know, all of us, none of us are perfect. The soul is pure, but the soul is not perfect. So every lifetime, the soul goes through all these lessons because it is striving for perfection. That is why our target as a soul always should be self-mastery and soul mastery. If your aim is soul mastery and self-mastery, that means you are, you know, you are purifying yourself to such an extent that you are becoming more and more perfect. The more perfect you become, the more perfection you will attract in your life. All that you attract in your life will be perfect, whether it is, you know, your profession, the love that you're looking for, the relations that you're looking for, everything perfect you will be attracting because you are reaching and achieving perfection. So different lessons, although I've had a very, you know, I've had a very, very roller coaster life with a lot of, you know, hardships and things like that. But at the same time, I've learned so much in this lifetime that I'm actually very grateful for having such a, you know, tough life. So I was just sharing, I'll share with you also. It's fun, but you can learn a lot of things out of this. You know, when I was 10 years old, that is the time when I went to this trekking. I would not say it's expedition because we didn't use, you know, those mountaineering tools, but it's a high altitude trekking to this mountain called Kala Pathar, which is on the Everest base camp. When you reach the Everest base camp, from there, you actually see the glacier, you know, from the base camp, there is a glacier in front, and after the glacier, then the climb starts to the Everest. So in this glacier, there is a mountain called Kala Pathar. And when I was 10 years plus, I had completed 10 years. This was in 1980. I had just completed 10 years. And me, my mother, my father, and there was another uncle who had gone with us. So we had been there. And it was, it's in Nepal. So everybody, you know, were there. Of course, the foreigners used to be, only there were foreigners who had gone. You know, we used to meet as we were going up, climbing up, and when we were coming down, they were amazed to see us, you know, especially me. Now this child, she's walking, and I had a small little rucksack on my back with my own water and own, you know, chewables and eatables and some, you know, essentials. And I was walking, and on the way, the last camp that we had, second last camp, when we reached there on the way, you know, when we started walking in the morning, this place is called Thiangboche. Thiangboche, it's a very high altitude place. From there, actually, you start, it's almost like a expedition because after Thiangboche, there is no vegetation. All greenery is over. It's only rocks and rocks and only terrain, you know, and you can see all the mountain peaks. So as we were walking, I was just telling this uncle, you know, I've never seen snow. I wish I can see snow. He said, if you're lucky, you will be able to. And I had just said, and what happened, you know, it started drizzling. The moment it started drizzling, my father said, come on, take out your, you know, raincoats and wear it. rucksacks have to be covered with all its, they have those waterproof covers. So we covered those. I wore my raincoat and we were carrying on. And after a while, suddenly I see in front, gradually it was becoming, whitish. And as it was becoming whitish, I saw on my shoulders, it was actually snowing. And I was so excited. Wow, it is snowing. Now, lesson to be learned, which I realized later, though these places are so pure, the energy is so pure, so every thought of yours instantly manifests. Whatever you think, instantaneously it manifests. That is why in the ashram, in any spiritual school ashram, especially our ashram, the Arhatik ashram, Master has programmed it, with so much of pure energy. When Mahaguruji had instructed him to come to India and go to this place, create an ashram, he wondered why he told me to go to this place far away from Pune. He did not know because he was a foreign national. So, 70 kilometers away from Pune in the forest region, dense in the forest, in the mountains, river flowing at the bottom. Why did he bring me here? So much, the forest was dense over there. But while he was, when he bought those land, huge, mountain after mountain he bought, and he had to pay, when people came to know of foreigners trying to buy land over here, they charged him 3 times the money. And he wholeheartedly paid because he said, if I'm taking care of your propensity to earn 3 times, I will also earn 300 times when it is, when I'm due to earning money. So then, when the forests were being cut and things were being cleared off, then we all realized that mountains were filled with crystals everywhere. If you go to the ashram in certain areas, especially the mountain behind, when we go there for meditation, anywhere and everywhere there are crystals lying. Nobody touches, nobody even, does anything. Those crystals, you could find maybe diamond lying there. You could find maybe, there are amethysts, there are rose quartz, there are so many kinds of crystals lying. Now, why he has made it Arhatik Yoga Ashram is because by the time you become Arhatik, your virtues become, refined. You are purified to that extent that you do not steal, you do not tell lies, those are already polished. You are in the process of, becoming perfect. Self-mastery is your aim. So he realized that crystals, what they do, they heal, they magnify whatever is there. So if there is happiness, peace, joy, it will magnify. If there is negative this thing, it will magnify. Whatever it is, it will magnify. So Master programmed it that those crystals in this whole area, today we have 300 acres of land. Okay, there it's like a village, you could say, almost so many mountains. He created, he programmed it in such a way that there is a whirlpool like this of energy which comes down from heaven, from universe, from Mother Kuan Yin. It's like this, it comes down. If you are a very proficient clairvoyant, you'll be able to actually experience it. Experience, of course, everybody experiences, but maybe you will be able to see it. And this energy comes down like a whirlpool, and it heals the whole of Mother Earth, and especially all those people who come there. It heals them. And then it, like a whirlpool, like a tornado, it goes down into Mother Earth. So all those negative energies, toxic energies, all those things are flushed out from us, from people, from Mother Earth, whoever needs to be healed, and it goes down and gets buried into Mother Earth. So that is why in the ashram, we have the main study center and the meditation center where we all do group meditation. There is a huge pyramid made of gold, real gold pyramid. We sit under that and we meditate and we pray. And there is another big hall which has gold domes. Those are for high-level practitioners to sit under those domes and meditate. Because gold energy is divine energy. The divine energy, the solid gold that you see is the crystallized form of divine energy. So the universal healing divine energy is actually whole energy. So when we do pranic facial, you know what we do in pranic facial, we actually use that gold energy to do facial, and real gold glow comes on the face and the body of the patient. We do not have to use any chemical to give a temporary glow. There's a permanent glow that comes when we do pranic facial for our patients or clients. Okay, so it is programmed in such a way. I mean, when you become arhatics, those who are not, when you go there, you know, you will feel absolutely, you'll be in bliss. So much of peace, so much of happiness, so much of joy, you will feel you've never experienced. Whenever we come back from the ashram, we actually tell each other, okay, I'm going back to Mother Earth. So we feel we are actually coming back from heaven. You know, there's no tension, no worry, nothing. There's only tranquility, only happiness, joy, peace, everything. You know, why I'm telling you this is at the ashram, whatever we wish, whatever we think, whatever we say is million times more powerful. It manifests like this. Immediately it manifests. Okay. So I wish, you know, the earlier you become arhatik, the better, because the moment lockdown finishes, I can take all of you to the ashram to experience that bliss, that joy. We can have discourses there, you know, sessions over there. Okay, and so I took this reference because in that mountain, the moment I had wished I want to see snow, in no time, it had manifested. And, you know, we were walking, and then what happened? The snow actually, the path became totally that rocky full face where it was only barren land. It was all white. By the time we reached where we had to reach, that was the second last camp, Gorukship, it is called. Over there, when we reached, there were just two camps over there, two small huts. The snow had risen to about 2 to 3 inches already. So, you know, when I was stepping, the foot was being, you know, it was dipping inside, okay, little bit. And then by the time we reached, I think about an hour before that, there was a blizzard, snow blizzard, which had started. So these snowflakes were coming and piercing us. So we had to cover up completely. Otherwise, it's so sharp that it can actually, you know, tear your skin and your skin may bleed. Blizzard, when there is snow blizzard, it is very, very sharp. I mean, I have experienced, so I know what really it is. It was very sharp. Mm-hmm. So we reached there, and when we reached inside, we saw a huge hall. It was like a dome, okay? So a huge hall in which inside there was a bunk, big bunk on which, you know, there were people with sleeping bags on the top. It was like a tire, you know, upper tire and lower tire, ground tire. So there was on one side, there was a big fireplace and people were cooking over there, their food in that fire. And we went and we kept our rucksacks. We occupied, there was free place, some empty vacant place. We occupied that place and, you know, we were so already, we were like frozen. I was absolutely frozen. My fingers were numb absolutely on the toe. And so quickly, you know, we kept our rucksacks. We went near the fireplace and we were, you know, especially my parents, they were, you know, near the fire, they were warming themselves. And I was, of course, I was young. So I was, you know, jumping around and I always had I used to get along well with everyone. So all new people. So I was chit-chatting with them, hopping from this to that. And, you know, so I got to know there was one bunch of people who were from Germany. There was another bunch who were from Alaska. And then these were the three groups that we were inside. In that particular so-called, I wouldn't say it's not really a hut, but let us name it a hut, okay? Station, I would say, okay? And the blizzard continued for 3 long days. So we all were stuck. Our water got over. Everybody's water got over in 3 days. There was no water left. We had to get snow from outside and, you know, burn that and melt it into water and drink. The wood was getting over. Of course, food grain we had enough because there were so many people, so everybody had food grain. But it was so very scary, so scary. This thing had risen to 10 inches, you know, the snow. And it had reached, there were like windows, though it had reached in the windows. In fact, the door got locked. We could not open the door. And it got locked and we were stuck there. There was no, phone. Of course, there that time there was no phone or anything, but there was no communication with the outer world. And everybody was just praying. Of course, I did not realize I was so young. Everybody was praying. And, you know, the weather was such that we could not really know whether it was dark or it was light. It was always almost the same, you know, like polar regions. It was like that almost. So this happened on the third night when we were sleeping. Suddenly midnight, I mean, I could not feel the tension, but you can understand that people were really going, it was, life was being threatened actually. It was like that, you know. And third night, suddenly there was a lot of noise coming from outside. So everybody woke up, what happened? And they just looked out from the window and it was amazing. The blizzard had stopped and it was full moon, you know, and the moonlight was falling on the snow. It was all white, silvery. And we could see just outside the next hut that was there, the next living station. Some people from there had come out. In our hut, we didn't have Alaskans. Alaskans were in the next hut. In our hut, we had some Americans and Germans. So there were these Alaskans who had come out, young boys with their, they had all come friends. They had come with their, one father was there and all those young boys of 21, 22 years, Alaskans. They had come out and, you know, they were like cheering and they were actually making a snowman. And the moment we saw this, we knocked on the window glass, please help us to come out. So from outside, they removed the snow from our door. I don't know how they had come out. Must be they had equipments. Yes, right. They had equipments. Correct. They had gone on a mountain climbing, actually. Not a major one, but a small one. So they came and they took out the snow. Our door could open and then we could, go out. And it was so amazing. They were throwing snowballs. And I was like, wow, this is snow. I'm experiencing snow. And by that time, of course, our clothes were dried at that point of time. We had the plastic sheets we always used to carry, excess, you know, because you never know when you need plastic. So we had created, we Indians, my parents, me and that uncle, we had actually made plastic shoes out of those. We had wrapped our feet well with those plastic sheets, cut them out and made those. So because we did not have snow boots and all, we were ready for it. So we wore those and then we wore our shoes, and from above the shoe also we had wrapped a little bit of plastic so that it doesn't get wet. And it was so blissful. But I know, of course, everybody was very happy, but at the same time there was an undercurrent of stress and worry that how are we going to go back. In fact, the next day, you know, rescuers came, and some of them actually were rescued, and they went. All of them went down. But my father was a very, very. I got my willpower and positivity from him. He was a very willful person. He said, "What we have started, we will finish. I'm not going to go back till I finish the destination." So we went on climbing, you know, and I remember when we went on climbing, there was so much of snow that my feet was actually going deep inside, and I had to pull out and take the next step. Again, pull out from there, again, take the next step. Again, it was going in again. And it was so surprising when the sun came out, and the sun was a little high on the sky, we actually started feeling hot, so hot that we started removing all our warm clothes. We were, of course, wearing all the warm clothes, and in the base camp we would require, so we were carrying jackets which are called feather jackets. The birds, high altitude birds, feathers are there in these jackets. Those are very, very warm. In the deepest of snow also, you will not feel cold. But we were feeling, I did not know that time when, you know, in the high altitude, when sun reflects on the snow, the ultraviolet rays, it's so pure that the heat of the sun, you can feel even more. And, you know, we were feeling so hot that we were trying to remove. Then that uncle said, no, 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 it will again create a lot of problem. Don't open. Even if you're feeling hot, you have to withstand this. So in that way, we completed our destination. And then when we were coming back that time, of course, when we were coming back, the snow was not there. We went to the next destination. We stayed there one or two nights. And when we came back, the snow was not that heavy. It was there, but not that heavy. Because, of course, with the sun, maybe it melted most of it. So, and this was loose snow. So when we came back, of course, it was a great victory for, I would say, for my parents, because, you know, what they had started, they had. So why I am saying this is that, you know, I have learned from this. I have learned that I should not give up no matter what. Till the end, I will try and then see. I learned courage. I learned to withstand hardship. I learned to enjoy even the peace, tranquility, all those moments to the fullest. Okay. When I came back, it was amazing. When we came back, when we reached Thiangboche, that particular, you know, place from where we had started to go to this Gurukshetra, we met a bunch of students from Calcutta. They were studying in 12th grade from a school called Lamartineers. Akhil will be knowing, Lamartineers Boys School. They had gone with their vice principal, had taken them. And, you know, they said, oh, we are going to go and climb. And they said, you know, the chief minister that time was Jyoti Basu. He has given us a grand, you know, farewell. And we are all there in the newspapers. And they were so much show off and, you know, all those things. But this vice principal, when he met me, he was amazed. Oh, such a little girl, you have come. And they saw our photographs and all, and he was really thrilled. So on his own, he shared his number with us. And he said, when you come back to Kolkata, please meet me. I want to share our pictures and I want to have some pictures that you people have clicked. So we said, okay. And then we came back. After a month or so, you know, my father contacted him. In the meanwhile, something happened, which I will tell you. So my father contacted him to share pictures, as he had said. And he said, oh, Mr. Sengupta, I'm so sorry. We could not go. We could not climb. The boys are not good enough to go high, you know, climb any further. We had to come back. So it was a failure for us. And I really appreciate that, you know, you have done it in such circumstances. And in the meanwhile, what happened was, maybe, I don't know from where, maybe my parents knew, I don't know from where. That time the Prime Minister was Mrs. Indira Gandhi. So she got to know that, you know, this is what happened. So she felicitated me because it was a world record at that point of time. At the age of 10, nobody had gone to Kalapathar in the Everest Base Camp. So, and I used to write diary. I had a habit of writing diary right from my childhood. So the publisher actually published my diary. And, you know, finally that book, that travel experience, that book won a national award in the year 1988. It won national award. Did it win in 98? No, not in 88. Sorry, in 83, it won national award. Best book of the year. Okay, now, then Prime Minister's office, they sponsored me to do all mountaineering courses from the Army Mountaineering Institutes that are there in India. So one of them is in Darjeeling, which is called the Himalayan Mountaineering Institute. So when they sponsored, first I went for the adventure course, then for the basic course, then, you know, you go for advanced course, then you go on expedition, then you go for expedition and all. So that's what. So when I went for the adventure course, I'm just sharing one or two incidents about the adventure course, which I shared on Saturday. Just to share that, you know, I had to tell you all these things. Yes, Ankita, you have something to ask. You've raised your hand. If you want to ask, you can unmute.
I was No, I was congratulating you. It is really, really
Thank
thrilled
you.
to hear all this. Yeah.
Thank you very much. So, when I went for this adventure course, just one or two incidents I will share with you. Lots of things I've learned in this course. Every child should attend this course. Especially if you don't need to go for mountaineering course as basic because basic course or advanced course is for mountaineers, but adventure course is for everyone to experience life's adventure. And that is why I made my children also do this course, you know. So there are lots of things taught in this course. One of them I will tell you is called survival course. So when I went, it was in 1988 that I was doing the adventure course in Himalayan Mountaineering Institute in Darjeeling. And that time the Gorkha Andolan was going on. So these Gorkha people, they were revolting against the government to have their own land. So there was no people. It was like lockdown everywhere. It was just like only the army trucks and buses were moving around. And this Himalayan Mountaineering Institute has a huge campus. It's like covering two, three mountains. Huge campus. So we were safe and secure inside the campus. But we could hear bomb blasts and, sound of guns and this thing shooting, outside. So this survival course is the institute decided we will not conduct it in Darjeeling, we'll conduct it in Sikkim. So they were taking us in those army trucks and army buses. So I was the patrol leader. We call those teams as patrol. So I was the leader. I was sitting with, the instructor in front next to the driver, and all the rest of the team was behind. And as we were going, I just saw plastic bags lying on the sides of the road and blood coming out of those. I could see bits and parts of hands and legs. So, I asked the instructor, "What is this?" He said, "Those are chopped hands and legs, which the Gurkhas have, done." And I was like, scared, amazed, shocked. And then I said, "Oh my God." Afterwards, I said, "Oh my God, I was having three cameras hanging in front. Why didn't I take pictures of those?" And, the instructor told me. In fact, my instructor, who was the head instructor, he was very fond of me. His name is Latu Dorji, who had helped Bachchendri Pal, the first lady who climbed Everest, Indian lady who climbed. So he was a teammate who had actually helped Bachchendri to go to the summit because Bachchendri was sick on the last day. She was having fever. So at the end, Latu Dorji, he had taken her on his shoulder and he said, "Chal, tujhe jana padega. You have to go to the peak. You have to make a record." So he was a very, very tough man, So he said, "If you would have shot pictures of that, tomorrow I would have to shoot pictures of yours because your head would be chopped off and it would be kept in a plastic bag over there." This is the kind of, the revolt that was going on in Darjeeling. And of course, that has also taught me. That taught me to face fears, to, when there's panic, when there's fear, to remain still, calm, and, integrated. So this survival course, when we were taken there, they take us individually, each one of us. We are taken inside the forest. We are left in the forest alone. Okay, we can't see anybody. It's only forest. We are left there with little bit of ration, water, a wood cutter, cutting, chopper, and a ground sheet to create a shelter for ourselves. So one day we would have to actually chop wood, cut wood, cook our own food, how to cook with twigs and wood that we would accumulate, cook our own food, create our own shelter, spend the day, spend the night. Next morning, they would come and pick us up and take us back. Okay. So I had a hale and hearty, being a, Lady Tarzan, a jungle person, a jungle person. I was enjoying myself. I had my songbook. I was singing. I was enjoying. I was taking pictures. And where I was staying, it was like a slope. So there were all these trees over there. From the slope, I could not see the bottom, but I realized that there's a river at the bottom because I could hear the river, the sound of the river, and I could see the other side of the mountain. And then, layers of mountains there. So I remember we were given Maggie and all, you know. So I cooked the Maggie and, you know, I was looking at it and I was saying, it looks so dull. I don't feel like having such a dull food. What do I do? So I had Haldiram mixture. So I did some garnishing on top, some decoration. It looks attractive. And then I was having it. Okay. And then I went to sleep. And then midnight, I woke up and I could hear some sound, you know, like this. You. And the sound was going again. You. Again, the sound was going. You. I did not realize what it was. I said, what is this? Anyway, again, I fell asleep. In the morning when I woke up, those instructors came and picked us up and took us back. We did not know that at night also they would come and check. That we were not aware. So when we met again, you know, and all the other team members, they were, some of them were like in the verge of crying and panicking. And, you know, the instructors were taking all the feedback, all the questionnaires, you know, and asking them what happened, what was your... Mandy told us a ghost story, a horror story. It was so scary. And at night there was this sound coming, joop, joop. And, you know, I'm sure that this ghost had come. And, you know, there were girls and boys who could not sleep. And then the instructors were just laughing. And they said, you know what it was? It was basically the mountain on the other side. And there was probably some big vehicle, big truck or vehicle, which was going around, you know, the street, the road. It was actually circling that mountain. So when it was coming in front, you could hear you. Again, it would go on the other side. There was no sound. Again, on the higher level, it was coming up. Again, it was going. So this is the sound. Okay. They thought it must be those ghosts, you know. So it was such fun. Believe me, that one night and one day taught me so many life skills, so many life skills. And on the way back, the instructors shared with us, you know, other groups, what incidents they have happened with them and what experiences. Like I will share just one or two more experiences. One group, you know, they were taken to, there is a place called Mirik Lake. There's a big lake near Darjeeling, which is called Mirik. People who have gone, you might have heard. So just behind the Mirik Lake, there is this mountain and these kids were taken and kept on the forest in that mountain. So one of them, it was a boy. He felt that, oh, where they have left me, I can see a, you know, nice like bed created as if it's a concrete bed in front. Let me go and create my shelter above that. He created his shelter above that. Generally in the ground, with the ground sheet, what people do, they just create, you know, they put four sticks and just like a shelter on the top. That is what they do with the ground sheet. But what I had done, I will tell you, I had, as usual, I always used to have plastic in my bag, ample of plastic. So what I did, I took a rope, which used to be there, of course, in our rucksack. So I tied the rope to a tree, pulled it and tied it to a stick. And I put the plastic from above. So it became like a tent and put, you know, big stones on top of that. So one side was guarded with the tree trunk. Other side, there was the stick. So that was my entry and out. And I placed the ground sheet at the bottom. So I was covered from all sides. There was no wind, no nothing. But others had not done it that way. So this boy, he said that this is a nice bed. Let me sleep on this and create my shelter. So he created his ground. He put his like a roof, the, you know, ground sheet on top with those. And he slept. In the morning when he woke up and the instructors came to take him, that is the time when he realized, when the instructor pointed out, he was actually sleeping in the graveyard on top of a grave. Okay. That time he said, oh my God, I don't know. I was sleeping on a ghost. I don't even know. Had I known at night, had I realized, I would have panicked and I would have had a heart attack probably. So, you know, we learn so many things with our own experiences. If you are perceptive, if your senses are high, every experience, small or big, that you have in your life is teaching you something or the other. If you sit back and introspect, what have I learned? Okay, there was this threat that I, you know, my teacher scolded me. Why did she scold me? What is the lesson to be learned? Okay, I'm getting scolding for the same thing over and over again from different people, or I'm facing this in life all the time. What is it that I have to learn? Every moment is teaching us lessons. Every moment is enriching us with knowledge, wisdom. Every experience is enriching us, right? So we need to actually understand, know, and then be aware, and you will see life is learning. That's what, right? So thank you very much for, you know, being a part of this experience, I have innumerous experiences like this. Maybe sometime I will share again, but thank you for your time and attention and for giving me an opportunity to share my experience, which will enrich in some way or the other. Whatever you feel, however you feel, this story, my life story, can help you. Do perceive that, understand, introspect, and maybe in the feedback you can write, this is what I think I have, got back, take back from this life experience that I have shared. Okay, thank you very much. I will see you tomorrow again. Atma Namaste. We'll do a closing invocation to the Supreme God, Divine Father, Mother, Guru Master, Chokok Sui, Mahaguruji Meiling, all the great, great ons, Holy Gurus, Holy Masters, Saints, Archangels, Holy Angels, Spiritual Helpers, all divine helpers, invisible helpers. Thank you for all your divine blessings, divine help, divine healing, divine love, light and power, with divine oneness, divine protection, prosperity, abundance, progress, success, growth. Thank you for enlightening us with all the knowledge, priceless knowledge, the experiences, knowledge, the understanding of life, understanding of everything around us and within us. Thank you, God. We are super grateful to you for entitling us and exposing us to such beautiful practices every day. Thank you in full faith. So be it, so be it, so it is. Om, Amen, Amin, Tathaste, Tathaste. Atma Namaste. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to serve you. I will see you again tomorrow. Bye. Take care.